We are in the midst of a fascinating study of the life divine in the chapter titled Rebirth and Other Worlds, in which he discusses the role of karma, the nature of the soul, and the means of, or the secret of, immortality. Particularly in this book, in The Life Divine, Sri Aurobindo presents every perspective of a problem. And particularly, when you look back at evolution and the nature of complexity of evolution, literally every perspective has been explored. If not by individuals, at the very least, if not by collectives, at the very least by individuals. But mostly if an individual did it, a collective also explored it. And if there were many ways of exploring it, then somewhere in history, somewhere along time, each of these angles has been explored so that everything may move to one grand reconciliation and unity and breakthrough. So first he starts with this question. What our normal demand of survival asks for is a similar survival for our mind, our life, even our body. If we are that as the true person, which is always eternal, always pre-exists birth, always survives death, shouldn't that be the case for our mind, life and body? That's what we're asking. Similar survival for mind, our life, even our body. Now, if you say you will survive the mind and life but not the body, we may still accept it as a compromise. But it will be a compromise. You would want ideally even the body to be able to somehow be as eternal as the soul. But if someone said, all right, that you can agree to drop, as long as your mind continues and your emotional being, okay, you would still agree. The dogma of the resurrection of the body attests to this last demand. This idea you will find in many religions, that somehow the body will be resurrected, and particularly in Christianity, in the form that it took place in later years, not necessarily in its origins though. The idea that the body is going to survive, and later into it came into the Islamic tradition, and therefore you had to bury the body because one day the angels will blow the trumpet and all the bodies will come back to life. Now, in the modern rational thinking, that seems so strange. And yet for a long time, it was the belief deeply rooted in the peoples from this perspective. And the only form in which it survives today is, of course, in the more gory cinema, where you have the zombies, the dead becoming undead and walking the surface of the earth now, representing the end of times, because now their bodies are decayed. What's the point of a decayed body surviving? So, but still this idea that it persisted for so many centuries, that it even came up as an idea, is important, because it points to a deeper truth, or it catches that truth and somehow warps it out of reality. You will find similarly in the Tibetan tradition, in the Buddhist tradition generally, this idea of what they call the rainbow body, where the monk has reached such a degree of tapas, different vocabulary for them perhaps, but the power of the energy of the sadhana is so intense that at the time of death, as he sheds his physical body, he concentrates his energy and turns the body into ashes, or dematerializes the body, or turns it into flowers, depending on traditions. But he continues to exist as if withdrawing from the physical into a what they call rainbow body. And this body is as if immortal, but it's not physically tangible. And the idea somehow is a permanence just beyond the physical, but close enough that it could be almost considered a true physical permanence. There is this frequent idea of some of the sages who have now acquired an immortality of the body. Ashwatthama is one such from the Mahabharata. He is said to still roam around the world in a body which cannot die because of whatever the nature of the story. Still suffering because of the wound, again from the story that comes. And what is interesting is there are people who have seen him, met him, and in physical form. There is similarly the idea of which was popularized by Paramahansa Yogananda, of his lineage emerging from Babaji, who lives in the Himalayas eternally in a body, always young. But when you go deeper into these stories, you discover the body is not in permanence physically. It is held in some subtle physical or subtle domain and materialized as needed for the purpose of physical contact, and then ceases to be physical when that contact is no more required. So strictly speaking, so far there has never been a physical immortality attained as far as we know. And yet our ideal points to that. Even so, he says, the dogma of the resurrection of the body attests to this last demand, and then he points to the new form that it takes place. It's no more rooted in the form of the belief that came with the religion, even as it has been the root of the age-long effort of man to discover the elixir of immortality, or any means, magical, alchemic, or scientific, to conquer physically the death of the body. And so he has captured the series in the evolution. Other than these religious forms, the next form it has taken is the age-long effort for an elixir of immortality. And you have so many stories. You drink this, you are immortal. But what is it that you have to drink? And the methods may be magical, alchemic, or scientific. It's interesting, he places all three together. If you try to analyze what is the distinction between them, you will not find a difference. What is magical, alchemic, and scientific? There's this famous statement from a scientist who said that if your technology evolves sufficiently, it is indistinguishable from magic. You take your mobile phone and go to a tradition, a tribe that has never seen electricity. You pick out of your pocket a little gadget and you speak into it, and somebody on the other side of the world speaks back, magic. What would they do? They would look at the form of it and carve it out in stone perhaps, and hold it to their ear and try to speak, or make that ritual if that was their tendency. But if you think about it and look at science fiction, going a few steps further of the same idea, it goes to a degree that you look at that and say, no, it can't be, it's impossible, it's too magical, it cannot be even science. But when technology does get to that point, well, it is science. So magic is nothing but the science which goes deeper behind the surface appearance. The word occult means hidden, concealed. Occultism or magic is nothing but the secret processes behind the appearance. And what is science? Digging into those secret processes. How is it different from occultism? Only in that the current model of science is exaggerated in its focus on physical processes or accessing higher processes through physical means, while occultism accessed those processes by non-physical means, use of mantra, for example. But again, science will give analogies to this. Creating vibrational patterns can actually solidify material or dissolve material. You could take matter and apply upon it certain frequencies of vibration until the matter just disintegrates. Or you could coalesce matter and render it rigid by application of resonant frequencies. So you see an analogy with the mantra, but the mantra is still mantra, mind focus. Not physical vibration, it is mental vibration creating a similar coagulation of mental substance or vital substance, not physical. So other than the fact that they operate in different bays of material, they are identical. Magic and science, and in between alchemic. Alchemic is the borderline where the two meet. Alchemy has a physical basis. You use mercury, sulfur, heating processes, mixing processes. But interestingly, it has a very strong psychological component. The alchemist has to have a certain state of consciousness or the physical process is a symbol of a psychological internal process. So the mixing of the mercury or the sulfur represents the masculine and the feminine principle. And if you look at the alchemical formula, it's a physical transcription of a psychological process. The transmutation of physical material from base metal of mercury or iron into gold is the transmutation of your consciousness from ignorance into illumination. And the analogies are so close that at some point the alchemist is found to be much more a spiritual practitioner working on physical materials in a deeply interwoven symbolism, which suggests in the long run that if I can transmute my consciousness by physical support, or I can infuse my consciousness change into the physical change, cannot your body also similarly transmute itself to become of its nature immortal gold? And so that's the analogy by which the alchemist also aims not only to change matter into gold for the sake of money, that's not the goal, to make the body permanent and immortal or divinized in some way. That's the analogy and that's the idea. But immortality. So the magical means of immortality would be, for example, and you'll see these kinds of stories in the magical traditions, that either there is a mantra for immortality, which you will repeat, or a certain ritual that you will perform, which draws certain powers that would make for the immortality, or infuse the powers into a liquid, which then you drink for the immortality, or whatever. But the focus of the magic in its peak was to make permanence or seek permanence of some kind. The same with the alchemy and the same with science. At its highest, at its most advanced cutting edge, science is also aiming in its application for permanence of some kind. If you look at artificial intelligence, there is a dream that perhaps we can upload our mind into the cloud, into some computer systems, and thereby become immortal. Or if you go into biotechnology, there's the idea that perhaps if we tap into the biology processes and modify peptides or amino acids or the RNA processes, get into the programming of the cells, we could unprogram the aging and decay, permanence and immortality, or at least longer youth or even eternal youth of some kind. Either way, the goal is somehow fulfilled when materially we can reflect the nature of the self and the soul, as we could perhaps in the mind and the life. Why are we seeking for this? What is the secret behind this need to make permanent? We could simply say, well, because the soul is permanent, therefore we seek to live it in the surface personality, which is all we know. And somehow we know we are immortal in there, so now we have to recreate it here. But perhaps also the idea is an evolutionary purpose, an evolutionary sense of nature in her larger goal, which is now what we are catching in our thinking. To stop short of this would feel for us as if evolution fell short. Evolution would be for us fulfilled and ideally complete when that immortality within is reflected in the immortality outside. So we come now to this idea. But this aspiration could only succeed if mind, life or body could put on something of the immortality and divinity of the indwelling spirit. Knowing that that is the only thing which is immortal and everything else necessarily must undergo change and therefore transition of death when it ceases to be what it was but something else now. The only way you can have the immortality in the form is if mind, life or body could put on something of the immortality and divinity of the indwelling spirit. And this is now we are entering the secret of immortality. There are certain circumstances in which the survival of the outer mental personality, representative of the inner mental purusha, could be possible. It could happen if our mental being came to be so powerfully individualized on the surface and so much one with the inner mind and inner mental Purusha, and at the same time so open plastically to the progressive action of the infinite, that the soul no longer needed to dissolve the old form of mind and create a new one in order to progress. The soul doesn't need to dissolve it if these conditions are fulfilled. And a similar individualization, integration and openness of the vital being on the surface would alone make possible a similar survival of the life part in us, the outer vital personality, representative of the inner life being, the vital Purusha. We're going to look at all this in greater detail next time, but right now we complete the thought. What would really happen then is that the wall between the inner self and the outer man would have broken down. And the permanent mental and vital being from within, the mental and vital representatives of the immortal psychic entity, would govern the life. Our mind nature and our life nature could then be a continuous, progressive expression of the soul, and not a nexus of successive formations preserved only in their essence. So they won't merely be the link point for this step, then that step, then that step. They would actually be an expression of this inner. Our mental personality and life personality would then subsist without dissolution from birth to birth. They would be, in this sense, immortal, persistently surviving, continuous in their sense of identity. I am still the same person that was after I have shed this body and taken on the new body. The overall personality can still continue. But there are these conditions which have to be fulfilled, and we are going to look at those in detail. This would be evidently an immense victory of soul and mind and life over the inconscience and the limitations of material nature. And in the next paragraph after that, which is the last paragraph of the chapter, he discusses, is that even possible for the body? And if so, what would be the condition for the physical body? But now we have got here the secret of immortality, practically for you to be able to literally shed the body and continue with the same personality into the next. But for that, the personality itself has to undergo three radical changes, all of which essentially are aligning it to the spiritual being within and representing it more and more completely through these three facets, which he has summarized as individualization, integration and openness. These will be the three keywords. First, it has to be sufficiently individualized. Second, it has to be integrated. And then it has to be open to the whole plastic process of change. But there are two different levels. You cannot join mind and life. Each has behind it a certain representative inner life being, inner mind, which are representatives of the soul. So there's a lot of new vocabulary here, which we will have to explore and appreciate the relationship between these levels, and then explore what that means and how we can consciously put into practice this process. I began this series with this idea, it's now perhaps the fourth class that we have, with this idea that it is urgent for us to be able to develop some kind of a sense of continuity of life across incarnation, so that what we have built up in this lifetime as a conscious spiritual orientation and a rich base of experience and even the gifts of the divine blessings we have received in this lifetime, that they can be carried over into the next without losing everything and having to start all over again in a new personality and learning it all over again, and how much time is wasted. And while the soul may continue in terms of consciousness, in terms of the struggle it will have with the personality, all of that can be so much reduced, simplified. And if this content and the sense of conscious intention and even the practical results of our growth can be carried into the next, how much more rapid the evolution would be for the fulfillment that we seek to realize in our evolution. And so we have now come to the crux of this and the method by which this has to be done, which we will take up next time in detail. And for the moment, I will just read this sentence which summarizes the process of this change, and we can then meditate on it. But this aspiration could only succeed if mind, life, or body could put on something of the immortality and divinity of the indwelling spirit. There are certain circumstances in which the survival of the outer mental personality, representative of the inner mental purusha, could be possible. It could happen if our mental being came to be so powerfully individualized on the surface and so much one with the inner mind and inner mental purusha, and at the same time so open plastically to the progressive action of the infinite, that the soul no longer needed to dissolve the old form of mind and create a new one in order to progress. So here we would have fulfilled the demand of nature, where she wants you to have that plasticity for the evolution, and the requirement for the soul's evolution to have a personality which can express itself as it needs, when it needs, without needing to replace the whole material all over again. In our study of the Life Divine, we have been reading the chapter titled Rebirth and Other Worlds, in which Sri Aurobindo has formulated the yogic perspective of person and personality. We are the true person as the conscious evolving soul that puts forward a personality appropriate for a line of experience that it finds helpful in its journey, in order to be able to grow through the life experience, to draw out a certain facet or power or powers of its development, of its innate potential, infinite potential as in a seed, using the surface experience of personality in the world, forming this personality using three sheets of the mind, the life, and matter, the physical body. In this, we have seen how the essence of the personality's growth and experience is absorbed by the true person, while the surface personality is dissolved successively through its three layers, and the essence of the experience absorbed forms a deeper psychic personality, which is also now our true personality. And this true person and true personality now, through successive incarnations in which it retains the full impact of past growth and experience and draws out from it the aspects or elements useful for the new life, continues to grow. So the true person and personality growing is within. The surface layers of surface personality and the false person on the surface are used as a point of contact with the world and then dropped as necessary. And the need to drop, we have seen, is present because the surface formulation is too narrow, insufficient for the possibilities of the inner which it wants to deploy. As a result, the memory of the past lives is to be discarded on the surface, and if it remains, it will only hinder the possibilities of the surface personality's free development and the possibility of the true evolution. And this, so far, has been our understanding that each of these surface persons is one step in a series of steps of the evolutionary change through which we rise to higher degrees of consciousness, and the fulfillment of the step of the surface formation is when it is discarded, so that it may keep a free space for a new personality and formation. It is the inner person that survives death, even as it pre-exists before earth, before birth. For this constant survival is a rendering of the eternity of our timeless spirit into the terms of time. And we saw the next paragraph where he describes why we feel, or how we feel, the need for persistence of the surface personality and even of the body, and under what conditions this can be made possible. But the need for this persistence comes from this truth, that the constant survival of the inner person is a rendering of the eternity of our timeless spirit into the terms of time. Our spirit is eternal in its base, timeless and even transcending time and space, puts forward a part of itself, a projection, which is the true person, entering space and time, and therefore able to experience growth. But this projection of the true person from the spirit, entering space-time, must render the truth of our eternity into time, and therefore it carries that eternity, or the sense of eternity, even as it grows. It is immortal. But if this is true of the true person within, why should this not reflect into the surface personality? In fact, because the truth of this reflects in the surface personality, we feel the need for the permanence of our personality. Even though we have seen the logic of why it should not be permanent, because if we persist in a narrow personality, it will prevent free growth of the true person. And yet, this is there as a reflection of the deep truth. And somehow it evokes in our mind the dream that perhaps we can make this as permanent as our true soul. This takes a certain form. In the Mahabharata, there is an incident where the wise of the five brothers, Yudhishthira, is challenged by a yaksha, a subtle being who presides over certain spaces in nature. And the yaksha challenges him and says, if you can answer my questions, then I will free your brothers who were rendered unconscious for violating his conditions of not drinking the water which belonged to him. Something. And so Yudhishthira says, all right, go ahead. And the first question is, what is the most surprising thing in the universe? And Yudhishthira's answer, which is the correct answer that the yaksha expects, is, although everyone knows that they have to die, everyone behaves as if they will never die. And if you think about it, somewhere deep within our surface personality, the eye of the mind, when it looks at itself, knows I was born, knows that there is an average human lifespan. If I am lucky, I can push a little beyond it. Someday it has to end, I have to shed the body. And yet in my day-to-day practical activity, I refuse to face that truth. I refuse to plan for it or act as if I am going to die someday. Because even to think that I am going to die feels wrong. Because my sense of I, even on the surface, is a kind of a reflection of the true I, which knows its immortality. And here on the surface, I feel, I recognize that immortality in the facts of my life, but I should be immortal. And that's why we behave as if we will be immortal. And when we finally have to face the fact that we are not going to be immortal, we try to prolong the life by whatever means possible, or if nothing else, imprint our stamp distinctly in the world in a way that the stamp will become immortal. So a wealthy person will create a foundation in his own name or in his parents' name who passed away as a way of instituting the name and immortalizing it, or create something worthwhile that will persist long after I have shed or died. And this need for immortality in the surface is what Sri Aurobindo has pointed to. The dogma of the resurrection of the body attests to this demand. And what is the demand? Our normal demand of survival asks for a similar survival as the soul, for the mind, life, and even our body. And through the age-long effort of man, there has been this effort to discover the elixir of immortality by any means, magical, alchemic, or scientific, to conquer physically the death of the body. And we saw last time these three: magical, alchemic, or scientific are really different facets of the same. In the Indian tradition, there are many alchemical texts, and they survive in ways that into the modern mind are surprising. Even as recently, I believe in the 1950s, there was a demonstration which is recorded in the newspapers of that period, where somebody demonstrated publicly how he took a large quantity of mercury, the metal, and mixed into it certain products of his, which is what they call the philosopher's stone, or the bija in Sanskrit, which is the seed, and heated it, and publicly before an audience of respected people, including judges of the courts, he converted it into gold, which was then validated by everybody. And the newspaper report confirms, records this. So the knowledge has survived. If today such a person declares that he can do it, he will surely be kidnapped and either killed or jailed to reveal his secret. And so the knowledge necessarily must lie behind the scenes. But the alchemical idea was not only that this bij, the seed, can transmute metals, but it can also in the physical body give you an effective immortality. We have a story which goes back to about 500 years ago. One of the greatest tantrics of relatively recent times, you know, in India, if you say 1,000 years, that's not very old. So 500 years ago is a recent thing. And he was in Orissa. His name was Achyutananda, a very famous name. And he was a master of the tantric and alchemical knowledge. He had, as demonstration of his great power, a being, a yaksha, subtle being, who was like a servant to him, whom he could demand at will to do things. The king once invited him, got him drunk, and then asked him, well, what's the phase of the moon? And he said, in his drunken state, he said, oh, it is new moon. And the king laughed and pointed out that it was not new moon, it was full moon. And so in the arrogance of his power, Achyutananda said, well, I will prove to you that it's the new moon. And he took a bowl of water into which the moon was reflected, and then did his magical incantation to cover the moon which was in the water, and it vanished from the sky, at least to the vision of people. Such was his power that he could conceal it, or as they would see it, he hid it into his bowl of water. But the end of his life is interesting. He wanted to help humanity. So he pursued this knowledge of alchemy and discovered finally the secret by which all illnesses could be healed and the human body could become immortal. And when he was ready to share this with humanity, his son came up and said, I'm sorry, I cannot prevent you, I cannot allow you to do this, because you will change the balance of human life and God's balance, and you are not the one who can counter God. Therefore, from my sense of right, I am required to cut off your head. So his father said, all right, since you are my son, I cannot refuse you. It's your duty, you perform your duty, and I will perform mine. And so he calls his yaksha, his yakshini, it's a female deity, it's a female form. He says, "Yakshini, come now and you assist me." And so he places his head, his son cuts off his head, and the yakshini promptly lifts the head and puts it back and joins it. And the father says, "Now that you have performed your duty, your work is done, and I am free to follow my duty." And he says, "Yakshini, let's go away." And poof, he vanishes. That's the story, popularly known, and never again to be seen. Some say he is still alive, some say he is in a subtle form, whatever. But such kinds of stories, sufficiently concrete in history to leave an impact that people do not forget, point to the fact that this quest has been and still continues to be so compelling to humanity. There are still the texts which describe step by step through 16 stages how to create that bija which will not only transmute base metals into gold but give you immortality. And there are still people attempting because the instructions are so clear. Except there are certain terms in Sanskrit, we are not too sure what exactly they mean. So there's always some cloudiness to the practice. In its current form in science, it has taken a very different turn. The idea is to be able to go deep into the biology and in the genetical science. We are able to watch how the genetics of the body degrade with age and therefore its functions also. And so there are attempts to trigger off body functions to neutralize the body functions degradations. For a while, about 100 years, they had this idea that certain glands from a young monkey had the necessary extract needed. If you infused it into the human blood, it would give you the youth and vitality of the monkey. And it was very popular for life extension or life improvement, at the very least to reduce the symptoms of aging. To this day, there are different kinds of potions validated scientifically in the lab. There is a particular material which is used in rats. It was shown that when rats were administered a large dose of resveratrol, the rats not only regained their youth, but the old rats were behaving like the young rats in many ways. In some of them, even the hair became black once again. And so this has become a popular thing for human beings to try to take. But it doesn't have as dramatic a result in humans either, because if you want to believe the conspiracy, they don't give you the same thing, or they give you a diluted form, or perhaps the human beings are slightly different from rats. We do not know. But at a genetic level, there are materials which reverse the aging process, which is measured in the genes by the reduction of the telomeres, the ends of the chain of the genes which become shorter until the genes' protection breaks down, and so they degrade and you have aging, or at least that's the logic of it. If you can reverse the telomere growth, and so there are again certain products which seem to be able to do that, not only in rats but in humans. They seem at best to extend the quality of life into age. In rats, certain products have been shown to increase, and especially in worms, to increase lifespan by up to 30%. And why not in human beings? We do see, though, a trend with better quality of life, both psychologically and physically, that there is an extension in lifespan. And yet it does not quite come close to what we hear from old stories. If you go back to the Mahabharata or in the biblical tradition, you know of the older people of these traditions who used to live for 1,000 years. And somehow we, having a typical age of 70 to 80, somehow does not match anywhere near that. We can understand going from 70 to 80, from 80 to 90, or even from 100 to 110, but 1,000 is still a big difference. What can be done for that? Recently there's been a huge investment by some of the most powerful non-pharmaceutical industries, including Google, in anti-aging technologies. We hear stories from people inside the system who claim that they have actually broken through the secret and can now extend lifespan even by many decades, even by a few hundred years. Whether it's true or not, It does not change the fact that after a few hundred years, you would still experience the decline and aging. One of the persons who was part of these programs even declared that in a few years they will reveal the means by which they can push the human lifespan to 1,000 years. Now consider what would happen to you if you lived for 1,000 years. If it is the same personality, and your personality increasingly becomes more restrictive, less flexible, what would happen? Already we see from the point we have hit 60, when we compare ourselves with children who are in their teenage, some of the things that they're able to do, we cannot do. And to the extent that our personality refuses to do, I gave the example last time of using mobile phones with touch screens or tablets or computers, somewhere within we feel ourselves unable to or refusing to. Even if we do, we find it so difficult to adapt. So it is a narrowing of the flexibility of something, not just the body, but the mind. And you feel out of place in the world. And if you were to push this now another 100 years, imagine how much more out of place it would be. And if you push it to earth for 1,000, you would feel a bit of a relic, being quite unable to synchronize with reality. So these possibilities are actually explored in other ways. Humanity wants to explore what it could be like, and often it is in science fiction that these explorations go forward. There were other similar explorations which also are fascinating for the conclusions that they come to. But all of these point to the fact that Sri Aurobindo has placed before us. We would not feel satisfied if the personality did not change sufficiently. We would stop growth individually and then eventually in society collectively if there is not enough change of the personality. And it's the reason why, as we saw last time, nature does not consider this to be important and does not make much arrangement for the continuation of the personality. Now we come to the key here. But this aspiration could only succeed if the mind, life or body could put on something of the immortality and divinity of the indwelling spirit. And this is the logic of immortality of the surface personality. Remember, what is immortal? As the soul, the true person, reflects the immortality of spirit in its individuality, in the psychic being. And if anything of the surface, mind, life and body, must share in that immortality, then they too should reflect or take on some character of the spirit or of the psychic being. The only thing which is unborn, having no beginning, therefore can be without end. We discussed last time the logic of why things have to end. When we are born, that is emerging from an agglomeration of substance. That's what born means. Something gathered to form you. Then the thing around you continues to change while you don't change. And eventually you cannot draw sustenance from that environment anymore, unless you keep up with the change. And if you keep up with the change, eventually the change is so great, you are no more who you were before. And so you have effectively changed so much, you are not the same and you have died and something else has taken its place. That's what it comes to. If you think about it in this way, anything which is born emerging from limitation and living in limitation will eventually collapse in its limitations as the universe moves forward, in order to keep up with the universe or lose the synchronization with the universe and become irrelevant. And so the key is this: to put on something of the immortality and divinity of the indwelling spirit. And as that factor grows in you, that aspect or that part, not being essentially born or made from an agglomeration of things, acquires the capacity to stay on. So this aspiration could only succeed. This is the only condition required, that it has to take on this. If the mind, life or body could put on something of the immortality and divinity of the indwelling spirit, immortality and divinity, the two are related. Immortality is the state of consciousness, of the sense of never being born and always being. And this state belongs to that which is unborn, which is divine. And the divinity is that which manifests all those qualities which belong to the divine. Its nature of wisdom, consciousness, its substantial character of the Satchidananda, and so on. So something of those things must put on the mind, life and body. And then Sri Aurobindo says, there are certain circumstances in which the survival of the outer mental personality, representative of the inner mental Purusha, could be possible. Now it's left in a kind of a vague thing. The circumstances do exist, but within those circumstances, it could be possible. He doesn't say, if you fulfill these circumstances, it will happen. Because the circumstances themselves are not enough. They are a precondition. Once the circumstances are fulfilled, there is still the factor of reflecting in those circumstances the character of the something of the immortality and divinity of the indwelling spirit. So you will see the circumstances describe something which is part of the surface personality, but that's not enough, that's a precondition. Upon that, the inner must reflect. If these two conditions are fulfilled and the soul accepts to carry, remember the soul has the choice, it accepts to carry, then yes, this would be possible. The phrase he uses, survival of the outer mental personality. Not the inner personality, outer mental personality. That's this part of your mind that says, I am conscious. I am this person which is thinking. And that's the most surface part. What is the inner part of the mind? And he says it is representative of the inner mental Purusha. The inner part of the mind is that part of which your mind is not conscious. And yet there is a constant interchange between the inner and the outer. Let's take a simple example. When you have to remember something, do you remember what time you woke up in the morning? Your mind instantly turns to look back, so to say, at your past memories. And the memory of that time either is vague, your mind remains focused, and then it pops up. When it pops up, you recognize, ah, this is it. But you did not actually delve into all the memories of your brain or mind to drag it out. Or even more obvious example is to pick something from your entire life, which was the most happy moment of your life. And now you have a whole lifetime, whatever number of decades that you have memory of. Your mind does not need to go through all the memories of every day of all those decades. It turns with an intention, and then out of somewhere, one or two memories come up, and then your mind chooses between these two and says, yeah, this one is more than that. But how did those memories pop up? Who did that? Who knew them all? And who, in the response to your turning within to seek an answer, pushed forward the memory that you were seeking? And that's the inner mind. The entire domain of the inner realm of consciousness is opening out to infinity, eventually into the universal mind. Between that and your surface mind is a gap. It is this gap which makes you think that you are only this surface mind. When you go into deep sleep and the surface mind shuts down, goes to sleep, your consciousness does not lose consciousness, it continues in those inner layers. And sometimes it wanders in those inner grades of consciousness, memories of it remaining you recall as dream, or even in that inner consciousness which opens out to the universe, You wander out into things which are outside your narrow personality, experience those things, and when you come back, you may even remember doing things, meeting people or whatever it is, as a distinct memory of who? Not the surface waking mind, of the inner mind. And so because there's a gap between the two, you say, as I woke up, the dream began to fade away. Because you were making a transition from the inner mind to the outer mind. And if you take pains to try to remember a little bit, when you are in the in-between stage, your outer mind registers what the inner mind is still holding, and then you come out completely and only that registration remains. You've forgotten everything else. On the other hand, as you slide back into sleep, if you try to remember or you catch the tail of the dream, as you slide back into sleep, the full memory of the dream might come back, and then you will lose the memory that you remembered because you've slipped into the inner mind and the outer mind is shut down. There is an equivalent experience in the vital. Your life energies and your narrow personal energy, which forms your vitality, is the surface vital. There is similarly the inner vital, which opens out eventually and joins the universal vital. Similarly, a physical body also has an inner physical grade, which is much more plastic, although as dense as this physical body. So the real personality of which you are not conscious is in the inner mind, inner vital, inner physical. And this outer mind personality represents something of the inner mind, but in a very limited way. And yet you have in the outer mind the sense of I am conscious, a center of your mind. That outer mind personality and its sense of center is a reflection of the center of the inner mind. And the center of the inner mind is what he calls here the inner mental Purusha. When in deep meditation, your consciousness goes within and becomes aware that you're aware and holds in a mental position this poise of awareness, conscious of the field of your mind, conscious of the thoughts which come in and go, you may be partly interiorized in the inner mind, but the sense of I there, witnessing, not actually thinking, simply aware of the thoughts wandering, is the inner mental Purusha. In a sense, it's a reflection of the poise of the self in the consciousness of the mind. There's a similar reflection of the poise of the self in the vital body and consciousness, which would be the inner vital Purusha, and a similar reflection in the inner physical Purusha. Because there is an inner mental Purusha, on the surface of the mind you have also the sense of I am conscious as a center, a Purusha, as the center of your personality. But it's not a Purusha, it's actually the center of a whirlpool. There's the whirling of the thought and a kind of a referential center which is not fixed, unlike the true Purusha. It wanders. When I'm depressed, my sense of center sinks and I'm thinking, oh, what a miserable life I have. I am so whatever. And then when the same consciousness shifts, because the whirlpool center has drifted now to a higher state, and I'm conscious in the higher place, I say, oh, I'm so lucky. Why was I thinking those thoughts? But the I, which is the center of the whirling consciousness and thoughts, is wandering. It is not fixed, unlike the true center of the mental Purusha. It's wandering. And therefore, nothing in it really has the character of permanence. Although in the mental consciousness, there is a center which is of permanence. Because it exists, it compels on the surface in a reflection the sense of a center where I feel I am the center of my thoughts and I can control my thoughts. But the control is partial because, as I said, it's only a temporary center because of the nature of the world. So it is to this he is referring. And now we reread the sentence, you will see what it means. There are certain circumstances in which the survival of the outer mental personality representative of the inner mental Purusha could be possible. And so you see, the outer mental personality represents this. It has the sense of individuality because it reflects the inner mental Purusha. But the true power of permanence is closer to the inner mental Purusha, not in the surface mental personality. So something is required now for these two to be linked. And now he says, what are those circumstances? It could happen if our mental being came to be so powerfully individualized on the surface and so much one with the inner mind and the inner mental Purusha, and at the same time so open plastically to the progressive action of the infinite, that the soul no longer needed to dissolve the old form of mind and create a new one in order to progress. So the mind should now be following these three conditions, such that the soul will say, there's no point dissolving this because I can actually continue in this. But still the choice is in the hands of the soul. The soul may say, it's almost there, but not good enough. I still want to dissolve it. It's choice. And its choice meaning your choice, you the real person who incarnates. And at the time of death, just before death of the body, you never die. You should never say, I die or I will die. You never die. The body dies, the body is shed, whatever. At the time of death of the body, your consciousness is strongly pulled inward, comes close enough to the soul that the surface mind or the inner mind now reflects the soul's perception towards life. You look back upon the whole journey of life in a single gaze, in a single moment, the entire journey of life is gazed upon. And in that single vision, the choice is obvious. It's obvious and the thing is done. What this? It can take two forms. First, it may say, not yet, there's something to be finished. This often is the memory of people who had near-death experiences. Either at the time of passing due to an illness or particularly during accident. The person is driving, for example, there's a collision that takes place. He's conscious of the collision and then momentarily his consciousness is thrown out from the surface. It shifts to the inner because the soul comes forward to take seize on that moment. And in human time, it may be a fraction. And to the sense of the soul, because it comes forward, it is an eternity of the moment. It gazes at the whole life and makes a choice. No, I have still something to finish. And poof, the consciousness falls back into the normal surface. The decision was made. And in the collapse of the car, somehow you survive. And if the soul had said, okay, it doesn't matter, it's finished, then in the collapse of the car, the soul would use the occasion to somehow leave. But if it chooses to stay, it has the power to somehow prevent, in spite of the damage done to the car, to the body, to not leave the body, to infuse its influence enough that you recover and survive and so on, with whatever the consequences which the soul has already foreseen in a sense. But now if that memory remains of that moment, you will see the personality, the surface personality is changed forever. Suddenly the personality becomes so much more calm, detached, in some way impersonal and yet intensely loving and caring. All characteristics of the soul which momentarily imprinted itself on the surface consciousness, or the surface consciousness was pulled in enough to make that contact, and if the memory remains, this thing remains. You're changed fundamentally in your consciousness. But it should not need an accident to do this. We can do this consciously by a conscious interiorization and communion with the Divine Presence within, allowing its influence to fill us, shape us, and even to lead us. To that extent, we can be much more conscious of the inner. But when this decision is taken, it is by the soul. And so when the time comes to shed the body, even as a result of aging, the soul looks back and says, okay, I've done everything. But at that moment, it turns forward and it's obvious what it wants next. In the very thing which is most lacking in this experience, or the thing most required to complete it and give it the fullness for its evolution. And that choice is made at that moment as it turns to prepare for the leaving of the body. It's the reason why in all spiritual traditions, that moment where you leave the body is considered so important. We have in India this tradition that when somebody passes away, you feed the crows to satisfy any desires which may be remaining. And the idea is some element of the vital body attaches itself to the crows, which are also desire beings much more. And we have seen this even here when Pandiji's sister passed away. For 3 days the crow came and demanded food, and we gave it, and then it was gone and it never bothered again. And it was as if elements of the desire of the vital sheath, as they are dissolved, attach to things. Mother explains how even sometimes they may not be desire, but they are vital energy formations. They even attach to plants, because that's where they find themselves most easily, in affinity. But the teaching in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition uses this story to highlight the fact that what you aspire for at the moment of death is what you will become or what you will choose for the next life. And that truth is valid. Of course, it's not the surface desire, it is the soul's choice which is the truth of the incarnation. But that moment is considered sacred for this reason, because literally the next step is decided here, and all the rest is only a assimilation, rest and preparation for the next incarnation. So why is this important? Why are we dwelling on this? Remember, this is what the soul needs. It should be able to take this personality, and it should be able to recognize I can shape it flexibly as I want for my next step without needing to dissolve. And if it can do that, it can say, well, I don't need to dissolve, I can carry this with me. And it will shed the gross physical body, it will shed the vital body, and it will carry the mental body, not entirely again. The parts of the mental body which are still too rigid, it will shed and absorb the essential part which is now sufficiently plastic and usable, and carry it and infuse it into the next incarnation, now shaping it as it wants, because it's able to shape it. In such a case, it will be very interesting, elements of the personality can carry over in a dramatic way. I'm reminded of an example, which is, it's worthwhile to see this on the computer, on the YouTube. You will search for Amira Willigagen. She's a young girl from Netherlands at the age of, I believe it was 8, that she appeared for a performance or a competition which was called, it's a singing competition. And when she came on the stage, there are 3 judges there. They say, what are you going to sing? She says, I will sing an opera. The judges laugh. 8-year-old girl, what will she sing? And one of the judges says, should I block my ears? Will it be terrible? And the girl very confidently says, no. And so they wait, and the girl starts singing. From the very first moment that she sings, her voice changes, her face changes, her body language changes. You see there a mature, developed, aged woman, and the voice is so perfect and flawless in the highest style of the opera tradition. The judges can't contain themselves, and one of the girls, women judges, she gets up in excitement, unable to contain, and she says, oh, it's an old soul, it's an old soul. And that's true. Then they asked the girl, how did you learn? Who trained you? She says, I watched on YouTube and imitated. Now, what in a young girl from the age of 5 makes her want to watch opera song of all things and not cartoons and other trash? What makes her enjoy it? What makes her then want to imitate it? And what awakens in her imitation that flawless perfection of an adult who has trained an entire lifetime to perfect her voice? It's unexplainable. Try that with a child. Get a 5-year-old girl to say, I'm going to train you to sing opera. They will get pretty much fed up with the training. And she does it on her own. No one pushed her to do it. And then of course now she's a famous performer. As 13-year-old girl, she's singing on the stage with big adults. But in that moment, if you see the video, you can see the face change. And when she brings on the high notes, it's the body language as an adult who takes on the high notes. The element of the personality which had perfected the opera singing imprint in the mind vital complex, and it's not, and even to some extent the physical, that aspect of the personality the soul gathered, held into itself, infused into the new substance of mind life body as it is formed, and therefore in the personality of the child, suddenly with refines the greater. And in the body, instinctively, she knows how to shape her throat and her voice and her mouth. The training which people go through in adulthood for years to shape the whole vocal cords and the structure of the mouth, she has that instinctively as a familiarity or an ease. Listening to someone singing, she catches the form that she has to hold this. And in the mind and in the vital, there's a familiarity with it that she can now push it to the level that to her is her past life's perfection of that skill. Nothing else of the personality has come through. Just this, which the soul found sufficiently developed and worthwhile and plastic enough to carry. Now, it does not mean it will carry it for the next life. It may even be that in this life, after the age of 18 or 20, suddenly there will be a shift in her personality and she will say, look, I'm quite fed up with this. I want to do something else. But in this case, the soul chose and infused and developed it. In the next life, even if she continues in this life with the same skill, she may choose to discard it. And at best, there'll be a kind of an affinity to that kind of skill as a child, but the mind may say, now I want to develop my power of the intellect. She may become a computer programmer or an engineer or anything. It doesn't matter. But this principle, we have to recognize how it works. The soul can absorb the essential familiarity into the consciousness. And this principle actually takes place when the soul now gathers material for the new mind body. It infuses something of its mind consciousness which it has gathered. It infuses something of the vital if it has kept it. And when the physical body is being formed while it is still in the womb, a very developed soul might preside over its formation by infusing something of its consciousness into it. Or a less developed one entering the soul at the time of birth would still push forward certain instincts of the body, in the body, as an instinct of the life energy, which shapes now the body, not only in its behavior, but even in its subsequent growth. From a newborn to an adult, the entire body's substance and tissue undergoes many, many changes, and many times over. So if you infuse a sustained will of the life force, as the body grows, as it develops, it shapes the physical form of the body to a degree that even it can infuse in the nerves a greater sensitivity, in the brain a greater complexity, in the physical muscle also a different plasticity or consciousness as the body grows, if the soul carries all this and chooses to infuse it. Now, all of this is very important for us to understand what this nature of the transition will be. If all of this has to be carried over, all of this which you want to carry over must fulfill the three criteria which she describes here. And that's why this detailed discussion of the carryover process. From this, it will be obvious why those three criteria are so important. Even this will go so far, if the inner instinct carries certain impressions of the physical form of the body, the soul can infuse elements of it into the new physical tissue. And although at birth the face of the child is more pliable and not so obvious, as it forms itself within a year or two, the face will begin to acquire the character of the infusion of the soul's will or consciousness. And then we will see suddenly in this family, everybody resembles each other to some degree, but this child is unusual. Not only appears different, behaves different, has different values, For example, the child suddenly feels it hates meat in a family that in which everybody eats meat for generations. The child is, I know people like that, they throw the meat under the table or hide it behind somewhere until eventually it's discovered. But why? What in you is creating the distaste? And it comes in the smell. Because somewhere inside the familiarity of that old personality and its sense of sensitivity to certain vibrations has been infused in the physical body and even the sense of smell. And the child says, no, that's not what I want. I don't like this vibration and smell. And a similar selection can begin to happen with the thoughts. Very quickly, certain values of thoughts, which are part of the culture, the child begins to reject or react against, shrinking from them to protect itself or affirming something and facing consequences of discomfort. Something of this type, almost all of us might have had in our childhood. If you have a strong spiritual orientation and you grew up in a family which did not have it, or even if it had it, you have something strong, you will find there were elements like this which were unexplainable in your childhood, which were brought over from the previous life. And it does not involve any memory of the previous consciousness required, other than this tendency of the consciousness. No memory of the personality. But now you can see how if this much can be brought over and more of this can be grown, it can even take the form where, in the case of the young girl, as she sings the opera, she has brief flashes of what it feels like to be on stage. Pictures may not arrive, but in the body, the feeling of that confidence. And you will see that in the video, if you should see this. Her whole body form changes as she sings. And if that much can come, why not brief flashes even of images? Why not then brief flashes even of certain memories, which are worthwhile selectively for the soul? And you can see now, once you've got to this point, progressively more and more of the previous personality could have been carried to the extent the soul feels itself useful for the new form. Of course, it may deliberately shed elements of memory because that will interfere with the free development of personality. Or if the personality is sufficiently formed, it may even keep those to the extent necessary. So now that we have seen this whole in detail, what are the most obvious things which are required for this transmission? The first thing is, there must be sufficient organization of that personality or that skill or that tendency of consciousness. In the case of the opera singer, enough organization of the consciousness of the affinity with the music, familiarity with it, the joy of the energy flow, and the particular imprint of consciousness in the physical body. All of this should have been sufficiently organized, individualized as a bundle, that it can survive as a whole. And let's contrast this with someone else who has not organized it. I'm a good singer, I can sing well, I have all this capacity and skill, but it is not sufficiently integrated that it becomes an independent bundle of consciousness. And you see lots of such examples. Only somebody who is trained upon it for an entire lifetime and built that individuality, even formed the whole life around it, would have created that kind of a very distinct integration of that whole bundle. So the first requirement is powerful individualization. Second requirement is, remember, all this developed here on the surface is still representing something of the inner consciousness which is reflecting the immortality of the spirit. It is the inner consciousness which is most close to the soul, which is the most absorbed. It is the outer part which is most fixed to the body and most discarded. So in this opera practice in the past incarnation, the woman would have had practiced this in a form that meant for her whole being's dedication. That it became a form of the inner being's aspiration to develop this and to sing in a way that the values of the inner being became the prime driver of the outer development. So It wouldn't be enough if you're a good performer. I perform on stage and we're in a traveling circus where I sing well, everybody claps, I go away, I've got my food for the day. That's not it. It would very likely have been a total dedication in a Godward aspiration, perhaps. Or in a dedication that involves a perfection which is so idealistic that it crosses the threshold of personal interest and acclaim or fame or other benefits which might still have been there, but they were not her primary drive. Only in that case, the inner values would have infused the outer, and the outer would then have been connected with the inner sufficiently that it could be absorbed into the inner consciousness and therefore carried by the soul. So the second requirement becomes the becoming one with the inner mind and the inner mental purusha. And the third requirement, with all this developed, there has to be enough plasticity that in deploying this in a new personality or new body, you shall not be narrowed down and blocked into it. Now here, it's not just the skill we are looking at. The skill itself now brought into a new body with completely new brain, new tissue, new circumstances, new personality, it can still plastically adjust to fill the new frame. But this discussion is much more now in relation to the entire personality, not just a skill which is absorbed. So, already what has happened in the case of Ameera Villigagan is that the society has pushed her into becoming another opera singer. She's now a big performer, you have 1,000 people coming to her performances, child prodigy and so on. She's been put into a groove. If the soul is happy with that, it may continue for a while, but as I said, once she comes into her own as an individualized personality, even she may turn against and revolt, or she may feel trapped if the personality is forced into it and so on. But in this case, we are looking at something broader. We took this as an example of the mechanism of transfer, and now we have to look at this in the aspect of the entire personality. First, we'll look at all three terms now. It could happen if our mental being came to be so powerfully individualized on the surface. The entire personality needs to be integrated around a center which is sufficiently stable and sufficiently formed that it can hold and carry its own. And so much one with the inner mind and the inner mental purusha, that means breaking the barrier between the outer mind and the inner mind, and infusing into the outer the prime drivers of the values of the inner purusha and the inner mind, and absorbing the outer activity until it merges into the inner consciousness so that the activity comes from the inner. I give the example of this singer. In her case, it would have been very likely there would have been a strong spiritual turn, and I don't mean religious necessarily. It wouldn't be that she's singing in the church. You could still sing in the church for God with that idea, and it's your job, it's your duty. It's not that. For her, it was a sacred experience in her consciousness. It had a sanctity or a spiritual content to the experience itself, and so that would lead to the integration of the with the inner mind and the inner mental purusha. And then at the same time, Sri Aurobindo uses this phrase, and at the same time, so open plastically to the progressive action of the infinite. Progressive action of the infinite is so critical. When the consciousness now works on the personality and works through it, it must find the plasticity that it can unendingly draw out and more, and more, and more, not only in skill and domain, range of domains of skill, but in ascension of consciousness. It should be plastic enough that whatever new demand comes upon you, you should be able to grow with it and rise with it. So now we will reread the sentence and you see the import of these three and the relationship of these three. It could happen. That is, the mental consciousness could survive into the next. It could happen if our mental being came to be so powerfully individualized on the surface and so much one with the inner mind and inner mental Purusha, and at the same time so open plastically to the progressive action of the infinite, that the soul no longer needed to dissolve the old form of mind and create a new one in order to progress. Remember always the reference, the soul needs to progress. And the mind is only your vehicle for that. And if anything in the mind is blocking that possibility, the soul would need to discard it. But if the mind is sufficiently individualized, unified with the inner, and yet plastic at the same time, then it can say, oh yeah, this is usable. And then the soul still will hold the choice. It's usable, but will I use it? And it may choose to. Then now, having discussed this in great detail around the mind, he says, a similar individualization, integration and openness of the vital being on the surface would alone make possible a similar survival of the life part in us, the outer vital personality representative of the inner life being the vital Purusha. The same thing on the vital level. So we don't need to go into detail. But briefly, what that would mean is your life energies, life instincts, and associated with it all the likes and dislikes and the sense of comfort. You see, the mind brings values. You go into a culture where they do things differently and you have a prejudice. That's your mind's limitation. But the vital limitation is when you enter a very different vibration of energy or a type of energy, you feel a shrinking. It's not a mental judgment, it's an inability to accept energetically a different way of being or doing. But effectively the same principles now operating in the level of the life force, and with it the entire bundle of life instincts which seep eventually all the way into the physical consciousness. What would really happen, having described all this, remember also here he says, similar openness of the vital being on the surface, which is what you're trying to carry over into the next life. It should become individualized, interiorized and bridged with the inner vital and the inner vital Purusha, and yet open and plastic to the touch of the progressive touch of the infinite. What would effectively happen when you accomplish this, even without a spiritual basis for it? What would really happen then is that the wall between the inner self and the outer man would have been broken down. And the permanent mental and vital being from within, the mental and vital representatives of the immortal psychic entity, would govern the life. Our mind nature and our life nature could then be a continuous progressive expression of the soul and not a nexus of successive formations preserved only in their essence. What is now is one formation, essence preserved, another formation, essence preserved. Instead, you will have mind-life frame carried by the soul transitioning in a continuity across bodies. But it will be still the soul that carries and develops and unfolds and grows. It means also you will have the sense of being a soul much more than the surface personality. Even if not obviously, not consciously, in the new personality, the sense of the soul might be behind, but it will be there because it will have brought the personality elements. And the sense of the memory would be there. It may still involve a deepening of the contact, a bridging of the gap between the outer and inner, which may not be so rigid. It may still involve the full identification with the psychic personality, but all of these would be easy and accessible because that has always been the carrier of the personality and its influence on the personality would be strong. And so, our mental personality and life personality would then subsist without dissolution from birth to birth. They would be in their sense, but they would be in this sense immortal, persistently surviving, continuous in their sense of identity. This would be evidently an immense victory of soul and mind and life over the inconscient and the limitations of material nature. That's the rest of the paragraph. What will be the limitation of this persistence? Because it's stopping short of the physical body. What are the nuances of this limitation? What is the life personality and the victory of the soul and mind and life over the material nature, etc.? We will study in more detail next Friday. But we have here the first base upon which a conscious practice can be cultivated to develop this sense of continuity across lives, that we do not have to start afresh into the next. We will see next time what the mother has to say about the need for this kind of a continuity for the purpose of this yoga, and in particular the physical transformation which is aimed at in this yoga.